So, we're back with another review of Fruits Basket, and just before I get started, I will say, I have read the manga and I'm aware of all relevant future plot points and details. For the sake of the review though, I focus solely on the story being told so far in the anime. It saves me from comparing back and forth between the manga and the anime, and allows anime onlys to join in too. And we're picking up the pace to the finale of the story now, so with that being said, let's get started. We start off the episode pretty much picking up where we left off with the ominous Kyoko's death reveal, and how that plays into Kyo's past. We see young Kyo sitting with Kyoko as she vents to him about her past and how she struggled to cope in the wake of her husband's death, as well as discussing how she almost wasn't able to keep living, only being able to continue because of Toru. And at first it seems like a weird thing to discuss with a small kid, but I guess it reveals a lot about Kyoko's character. Whilst it may seem like Kyo is a bit young to hear about that kind of thing, she recognises that he's lonely and needs a friend, and that he's aged beyond his years because of what he's gone through. That more than anything, he needs someone who's going to treat him like an equal instead of something made of glass, and I think it makes a nice parallel to how Toru treats him as well. He likes that she recognises what he is, but doesn't judge him or try to shield him. Interestingly though, I also think it shows how similar Kyoko and Kyo are. For an adult to sit down and vent about her life with a child shows how lonely she must feel. Raising a child all on her own without any help from her family and most likely minimal friends, it feels like they're kind of kindred spirits in a way. We then get a depressing monologue from present Kyo talking about how it was his fault that his mum committed suicide, and that in the end, Kyoko had hated him as we saw him stand near her body. So yeah, that's pretty dark. The disembodied spirits of his mum and Kyoko then begin to talk to him, with his mother telling him he needs to come inside the house or something even worse is going to happen, before he sees blood coating his hands and Toru's corpse bleeding out. And then of course, he wakes up from his nightmare in the middle of his room, in the dark, laying on the floor. Poor guy's having a rough time, and it does not bode well for his interactions with Toru. Something just tells me he's going to do something very, very stupid, very, very soon. Meanwhile, we see Toru, Momiji, and Yuki downstairs preparing some food to put in the grill in the shape of their personal mascots, whilst wondering whether Kyo's going to come down for dinner. And then we get some even more depressing monologue from Kyo, talking about how he must have had that dream to remind him about his place in the world, and that he was an idiot to think that Toru could possibly love him back, completely oblivious to the fact that she's waiting downstairs, all worried about him. We then go from one eerie scene to another, with Shigure finding himself alone with Ren on the Soma estate. Shigure confronts her about Rin being sent to retrieve Akito's box, with Ren once again showing her true colours and calling Rin a worthless child, so yeah, any sort of sympathy this character could ever have is rapidly going out the window. She just seems like the worst. They then begin to play some mind games with each other, with Shigure calling her a hypocrite for being upset with Rin for talking with Shigure, when Ren herself had promised not to tell anybody about the box. Ren then said that Shigure had implied that she should take the box from Akito, while Shigure of course denies this, but it's pretty clear to me that he's lying here. She then tells him that he should get the box for her, but he denies her, telling her it would feel blasphemous. Ren then agrees with him, telling him that only she should be allowed to touch anything to do with Akira, and starts to reveal just how crazy she is. Just the way she says all this gives me the creeps, and honestly, it's quickly becoming no surprise that Akito ended up so damaged considering what her mother's like. Imagine having to deal with somebody like this. We then arrive at a flashback scene where we get to have our first proper look at Akira. And this is pretty exciting. We've seen glimpses of him in brief scenes here or there, but this is the first time that we truly get to see what his character's like and how he fits into the family. We hear discussion on how another marriage talk's broken down and how he was not likely to survive very long, leaving the future of the family in turmoil. We learn that Ren was a maid working at the Soma estate and that she's likely been crazy all along. Considering the first time Akira sees her, she gives him some supreme crazy eyes and declares her undying love and devotion to him in her first words to him, whilst also recognizing how lonely he must feel. I mean, she even starts to cry. Big stalker energy here, and it's really, really creepy. But at least she does actually love him, I guess. But it's not like that makes it much better. We then see that annoying maid screaming at her that she's a lowly servant and she's not worthy of marrying the head of the Soma family. And Akira must have been the loneliest dude ever because he ends up marrying this crazy woman he just met and puts the maid in her place, telling her that Ren is the only person that saw him for what he was, saw his loneliness, and cried for him. It would be romantic, I guess, if not for the creepy music, the crazy eyes, or the knowledge that she goes on to ruthlessly neglect and abuse her daughter. Returning to Ren and Shigure, she tells him that she and Akira were the center of each other's universe, and they didn't need anybody else, which pretty much confirms she's simply jealous of the attention that Akito receives from everybody. That she's a sad and insecure woman that takes out her feelings on her only child with no regrets. It's pretty disgusting, to be honest. We then get a cute little scene where we get to see the four oldest Zodiacs all together as young boys talking about how baby Akito is going to be raised as a male. And this scene is pretty cute, and it shows that even then, Shigure knew what was up with Ren, telling the others that she should be pitied. It was also sad to see how Kurino looked to him for answers and even called him Gure like Aime does in the present day. It shows that they used to be close at one point, with Kurino clearly idolizing Shigure, and seeing how their relationships deteriorated to the present is pretty sad. Also, side note, it makes Ren seem even more gross for sleeping with Shigure. She knew him when he was a little boy. So very, very deeply disturbing. We also get to see how terrible Ren's jealousy is, with Akira revealing that she never holds Akito, who is a baby, and calls her a brat, lamenting on how much attention she gets. Akira then goes on to say that it's only natural that Akito gets attention, as she's a special child who's meant to be loved, which seems to trigger Ren. Like, can this dude read a room? And honestly, whilst it's commendable that Akira's sort of protecting Akito, he also sucks. He should have told his wife tough luck after Akito was born and not tried to raise her as a male. And he should have also sent Ren away if she couldn't love their child, instead of exposing Akito to such a toxic oxygen thief. Flashing back to the present, we see Ren start to put the moves on Shigure, trying to convince him that what he feels for Akito is not true love, and that he has a look of desire in his eyes when he looks at her. And then he agrees, stating that when he looks at Ren, he feels a rush of affection, but not for her, for Akito, as he fantasizes about what she would have been like had she been allowed to live her life as a girl. He tells her that he did want her to take the box, and that he thinks that if anybody should be tormented by Akira's ghost, it should be Ren and Ren alone. And then he storms off and Ren screams at him, telling him that there's something wrong with him and that she's the only reason that Akito exists, before breaking down in tears. It felt really satisfying watching Shigure initially lure Ren into believing he was going to be sympathetic to her, only to dramatically pull the rug out from under her and leave her looking weak and pathetic, which she would absolutely hate. Credit where it's due, he'd be fantastic at Game of Thrones. It's kind of frightening to see this jovial and funny guy suddenly flip a switch and become ice cold like when he was on the phone to Kurino, and it really adds to his character in my opinion. We then get to see Akito's memories of the day her father died, with Ren storming in after his death demanding to know why she wasn't informed he was going to die. The maid then informs her that Akito's the new family head and will be in charge of fulfilling Akira's final wishes. And this causes Ren to lash out, calling Akito a toy for Akira to play with, calling her useless, and telling her that nobody needs or wants her. Mother of the year right here. Yikes, yikes, yikes. Thankfully, Akito gets her back, telling her that by denying Akito's importance, Ren is mocking Akira's words and beliefs, and that she's the one that nobody needs. And of course, this causes Ren to rant some more and then break down, cradling Akira's corpse. The woman's truly disturbed. I'm honestly surprised they didn't do the memory wipe trick on her. It would have solved a lot of issues. We then return to present Akito as Kurino arrives to talk to her. She cuts him off and starts a monologue of her own, which is never a good sign considering she's about as stable as her mum is, telling him that when she first met Yuki, she was so happy, and could use him and the other Zodiac members to show off in front of her mother, and show her that she is special. She then begins to question when her world started to fall apart, and we get a nice little montage of all the abuse that she's inflicted on the other Zodiacs. And to me, this at least implies that she regrets it a little bit, but feels like she has no other option, like she's been forced into the role of the cruel jailer. It's revealed that the reason she let Kyo and Toru go and live with Shigure and Yuki is that she made a deal with her mother, that she'd allow the Zodiacs to move away from her control to prove that they would return on their own, or she'd leave the family forever. She says that she did this out of belief that she was right, that her father was right, but it's pretty clear that she couldn't have accounted for the influence Toru was gaining on the other Zodiacs, and the happiness she would bring them in contrast to the pain that Akito inflicted. And of course, no dramatic scene could be complete without somebody barging in, and this is exactly what Ren does, looking extremely unhinged while doing so, wielding a knife. She then threatens Akito, demanding that she hand over Akira's box because she's the only person who deserves it. And in response, Akito says she can have it and throws it in the air before the scene once again transitions into a flashback. We see Akito huddled next to Akira's sickbed as he tries to comfort her in the moments before his death. He once again reaffirms that she's special and that he'll always be looking out for her even after he's died. He then laments that Ren's not happy, and he hoped that Akito could make her so. That if he gave her a child, a special child with divine purpose, then that would help her go on after his death and prove that he and Ren were special too. And that's kind of sad, and it sort of plays into what Ren is saying after all. That even to Akira, Akito was more a tool to make his wife happy and allow them to try and feel validated. It's actually pretty sad, and so it falls to the head maid to make things right and ensure that Akito knows that Akira loved her most of all, even if it might be a tiny little lie. The maid then gives Akito the box, telling her that Akira's soul is inside and that nobody else except Akito can claim him. Back in the present, Ren discovers the box is empty and that it's always been empty, with Akito finally understanding that her father's words weren't true, that she isn't some magic child who's always going to be loved, and that the bonds are beginning to break. And honestly, the emotions are running so high in this room, it's almost comedic how they shift from one extreme to the next. Here is Akito attempting to make peace that the curse breaking is imminent, and then bam, she feels a surge of rage and picks up the knife going to stab her own mum. But she's stopped when we see another bond break, this time Heroes. And then we have one of the sweetest scenes ever, with a creepy soundtrack played over the top which kind of wrecks it a little. And the first thing that Hiro does is pick up his baby sister, who he could never hold before now, and this is how his mother finds him. And then she proves herself once more as the best Zodiac parent and just holds him and comforts him, consoling his grief rather than getting wrapped up in the fact that this is the first time she's ever held him as a human. She doesn't make it about her. The contrast between her and Ren is truly mind-boggling. Back to Akito, after a bit of Ren taunting and the maids arguing back and forth as to who's in the wrong, Akito leaves, followed by Kurino. He embraces her and tells her it's going to be okay, and it's not too late for her to change. Akito then replies it's too late to say these things, and he should have said it from the beginning, and honestly, I agree with her here. If he had helped her realize the bonds being severed didn't affect how much he cared about her, she might not have gone off the deep end trying to make sure they all depend on her so much. And then, she stabs him. Because of course, that's the rational response. Very yikes. I was hoping for a breakthrough here, to be honest. She then storms off, telling him he has to pay with his life, before a maid comes to help him and he collapses in the rain. And then we get a dark scene where Uatani, Kurino's love interest, finds a dead bird outside her work. And honestly, it's kind of funny, even if it's a little bit dark. It's a clumsy little metaphor, although I think it would have worked better earlier on before he was stabbed as a bit of dark foreshadowing. To finish this climax building episode, we then have a scene with Kyo and Toru where Kyo tells her he's going out and Toru follows him, determined to tell him how she feels. And then, the episode ends on this brutal cliffhanger. Nice. And that's going to be one hell of an episode to pick up on. This was a super dark episode with almost no humor in it. Usually I wouldn't like that because I like breaking up the dark with light, but I think in this context it worked really well. It would have taken away from the episode to slam a cheap joke in there and would have ruined the building tension. We got so much explanation as to why Akito behaves the way she does without impacting the flow of tension. It was gripping and exciting and it left you wanting more. That being said though, those are just my thoughts and now I'd like to hear yours. What did you think of the episode? Like it? Hate it? Make sure to leave a comment. And let me know.